Go ahead and start. It's about 4:05 now. So let's go ahead and begin. So it's my pleasure to introduce Dan Stamper-Kurn from UC Berkeley. I've known Dan many years since he was a graduate student in Wolfgang Kutterly's lab, where he was a co-author on the first BEC paper from that group, and on many subsequent papers on the study of collective modes and phonons, Beschbach resonances, Bragg scattering, Bragg spectroscopy. And these are accomplishments that eventually led Wolfgang to receive the Nobel Prize a few years. Were you still at Berkeley, Dan, when
I was Wolfgang already at prize? I was at Berkeley.
Okay. All right. So needless to say, Dan played a role in that big event. So at Berkeley, Dan has established a broad research program on quantum phenomena, including a really beautiful experiment on magnetic domains in spinner condensates. And I hope that we'll see some of those images today. I can't get enough of these remarkable spin domains that they could image in situ. Also, Dan has been involved in the development of novel optical lattices, in which he studied geometric frustration and lattices like the Kagame lattice that has flat band structures. So Dan has received many honors and accolades. He's won the Presidential Young Investigators Award, a Sloan Fellowship, a Packard Fellowship. He's a fellow of the APS and the Optical Society of America and a Jolly Good Fellow. And so, Dan, welcome to Rice. Good to see you back. Wish you were here in person.
All right. Thanks, Randy. Thanks, everybody, for showing up from wherever you are. And yeah, I very much regret that I can't be there in person. I mean, I visited Rice a couple of times, and I just love spending time with you all and seeing the labs and sort of osmoting some of your great community that you've established. So I'm sure there will be another opportunity when we've sunset on this COVID for us to see each other in person. For now, I'd like to tell you about research that my group has done on the topic of, broadly on the topic of magnetism. I think you'll see that the second half of the talk is only very peripherally on the topic of magnetism. But to put it all in context, maybe I'll offer again this idea that, what kind of science are we doing when we study gases of ultra cold atoms? And one of the ways in which this is described in a lot of the discussions these days is as in a form of something known as a quantum simulation. I have some misgivings about characterizing all of my research as a quantum simulation, but let me just provide this as a means of context. So first of all, let's remind ourselves how one specific type of science, let's say material science, typically proceeds. So material science or condensed matter physics is some sort of dialectic between experimental work and theoretical work. And new ideas for condensed matter physics sometimes originate on the materials end, where somebody finds a new material, probes it, and sees some new phenomenon, and then interacts with theorists who think about some kind of minimal model that'll explain the phenomenon seen in the material. And then after some refined calculations, they'll compare back to see if they can explain the material properties. Sometimes the dialectic works in the opposite direction. Maybe the fancy idea comes out of theory first, and then the suggestion is posed to some experimentalists to maybe find a material that might manifest some of the phenomena that have been predicted. Quantum simulation is sort of a third leg here in this kind of interaction. Quantum simulation can be thought of as creating a simulacrum of a many-body quantum system and studying it directly. So it can be regarded as an element of theory. So maybe theorists will pose a model and want to run simulations to understand what phenomena are predicted by that model. But maybe it's hard to do that as a calculation on a computer maybe it's easier to build some sort of ad hoc calculation device that simulates what the model is doing directly, and therefore we can learn what the model predicts. Or perhaps we want to understand the phenomena that occur in materials more by representing them in a really simple form, maybe stripping away some of the details or adding some of the details back in, and then see whether the phenomena are retained. So that's a way in which quantum simulations in a lab like mine can contribute, say, to the study of condensed matter physics or to material science. But to be honest, I don't know that this is really the strongest motivation that I actually feel in my work. I think sometimes maybe have to cast off these strong lines and just leave them as sort of suggestions. I think we've entered a regime where the cold atom system simply should be regarded as another interesting material in its own right. And sometimes it's a material which is constructed with the suggestions from theorists, but sometimes it's just something that we create in the lab and we study and we find interesting, just like it might've been some other material that we found that was. Okay, so this is kind of the spirit in which we're going to approach the study of magnetic phenomena in solid state systems. Magnetism has a lot of faces in material science, a lot of phenomena, a lot of causes for magnetism. So it's kind of a good area in which to explore physics kind of in general. So I'll present to you some examples from my work that kind of fit within this structure to some degree. The first is a study that we performed on a phenomenon known as magnon condensation. So first of all, I should tell you what are magnons and where we get them. This is an experiment which takes place in particular with something we call a spinner-Bose gas. And what it is the following. We're working with atoms of rubidium-87. It's an alkali atom, which has a one valence electron. So the electronic orbital angle, total angular momentum is 1/2. And the rubidium atom also has a nuclear spin. The spin quantum number is 3/2. And this atom then in its ground state has a total spin that can be either 1 or 2. So here's the energy levels that a ground state rubidium atom, ground electronic state rubidium atom would have in the absence of a magnetic field. And we can, for example, trap rubidium atoms so that they're free to occupy any of these magnetic sublevels, which is a manifold of constant total spin. And we'll call this thing a spinner-Bose gas. That's kind of the name it's been given. Now, this spinner-Bose gas, it can condense. When it condenses, it can also become ordered, not just in momentum space, but also in its spin degrees of freedom. And one option for it is to condense in a state that is also ferromagnetic, where all the atoms have the same orientation of their magnetic moment or of their spin degree of freedom. This ferromagnetic state, which nominally would be, let's say in a box, would have a uniform density, but also uniform magnetization, vector magnetization, has excitations. Excitations, which are long wavelength variations of the order parameter of the system. You can have a long wavelength excitations where it's the phase of the superfluid, which varies from location to location. These are excitations which are the phonons in our liquid. Or we can have excitations which are variations in the direction of the magnetization, gentle variations of the magnetic order across the system. And these kinds of variations are excitations in the system in the superfluid, and these are what are known as magnons. Okay, so magnons, these are the Goldstone bosons, if you will, that correspond to the magnetic order, in our case, of a ferromagnet. Now, how do I place magnons into my system? Let's say we've Bose condensed the gas and it's ferromagnetic and all the spins are pointing in the same direction. What's a magnon? A magnon is a tilting of the magnetic order parameter away from its initial location, its initial direction. So for us to introduce magnons into the gas is a very simple procedure. All we need to do is, let's say, apply some kind of radio frequency field that acts on the spins and rotates the spin by some angle. And depending on how far we've rotated the spins, we will change the longitudinal magnetization of the gas by an increasing amount and add more and more magnons into the system. So the number of magnons that we put into the system is entirely, in this case, controlled by us. They originate from the controls that drive the RF field. Now, when we take a longitudinally magnetized spin and we rotate it by a slight amount, we redistribute the population of atoms among different sublevels. So let's say all the atoms started off in this magnetic sublevel, a longitudinally magnetized gas. If I rotate it by a small angle, then I put a small population of atoms in the next Zeeman level down, and then an even smaller population further down than that. And I show this construction for a couple of reasons. One is, you can now see that if I want to identify the magnons in the system, I simply need to determine to image or selectively detect the atoms, let's say in the m equals zero state versus the m equals minus one state. Those atoms represent the magnons directly. So that's good because we know how to image them. A second thing is that once we've identified what the magnon is, we can ask what is its evolution inside of the system. Okay, and to tell you about that story, I have to add one more piece of the physics puzzle, which is how interactions work out in a Spinner-Bose gas. And this is, of course, what makes the Spinner-Bose gas interesting to begin with. Atoms in my Spinner-Bose gas, they will collide with each other. And let's say there's a collision where an atom in some spin state and an atom in some other spin state, they collide with each other. And after the collision, they maybe emerge in some other combination of spin states. Ideally, I would be able to describe the system fully by characterizing all these kinds of collisions with all the different input and all the different output channels. With a large number of magnetic sublevels, that could get kind of complicated because there's a lot of combinations for this kind of collision. But here's where certain simplifications and symmetries come to our aid. One is to recognize that collisions all occur at very low energy in these gases. This means, for example, that when atoms collide with each other, they're not going to change their angular momentum. Their orbital angular momentum. And then secondly, that the systems we're looking at, these are atoms that that interact in the same way if we just rotate the system all together. So there's a rotational symmetry that should relate, let's say, collisions between up atoms to collisions between spin pointing sideways atoms. They should be described by the same kinds of collision physics. Okay, so that tells us a couple of things. One is that we know because this kind of collision is the same as this kind of collision, we know that all collisions in this gas are going to be described only by the total spin of the incoming collision channel. So I have two atoms, they both have spin one. The total spin of these two atoms can be either zero, one, or two. Now, the atoms are only colliding at low energy where only S-wave collisions occur. So by Bose symmetry, a combination of atoms that has a total spin of one just can't collide because the collisions would have to be higher than S-wave. And then we conclude that all the collisional physics in this gas is just described by the strength of this collision, which is given by something known as a scattering length, which has a certain value in rubidium, and the strength of this collision where the spin is two, which has a different value for the scattering length. And for example, the comparison between these scattering lengths tells us that this gas is ferromagnetic. Another thing we gather from this picture is that magnon number is conserved in this system. So if I've done my work and I've produced a certain number of magnons in the system, a certain number of m equals zero atoms in a gas that is otherwise filled with m equals minus one atoms, how is that number of magnons going to change in time? Okay, so there might be collisions. Perhaps one of these magnons will collide with one of the majority atoms that are around. But in this collision, the outcome of the collision has to conserve the total projection of the spin along, let's say, the z-axis. And that means that the outcome of this collision is always that, again, one magnon emerges from the collision, and the magnon number will be now a conserved quantity. That now allows us to compare our physics to magnon condensation phenomena that are seen in solid state physics. So now I'm talking about solids briefly. Magnon condensation is a magnetic phase transition that is seen in a host of different magnetic materials, some of which are ones in which you can inject magnons into an ordered ferromagnet and have those magnons sort of remain in an excess number for a long period of time. And when that magnon number, that excess number is large enough, these magnons, which themselves are bosonic excitations, can Bose condense. Here's an example of a yttrium iron garnet experiment where these experimentalists injected currents into a magnet, injected electrons. These electrons, created magnons. The magnons Bose condensed, and they were able to see the presence of this magnon condensate by measuring something like a coherent collective transverse magnetization that occurs because of coherence between the magnon condensate and the ferromagnet in which it lives. So we decided to follow a similar procedure. We do an experiment where we inject magnons into a gas using an RF pulse. The magnons that we inject initially they start off actually in a coherent state, but we decohere them by applying a magnetic field gradient for some time. So now we have a thermal gas of magnons with no long-range order of the transverse magnetization, just noise in the transverse magnetization if you image it at the atomic scale. And then we go ahead and we cool the gas further while keeping the magnon number constant, or at least the fraction of magnons in the system constant. And we can drive the system to a low enough temperature where at that magnon number, the magnons will now condense themselves. And to observe that magnon condensation transition, we also, for example, focus on the transverse spin, and we look for the emergence of a large region of commonly transverse spin magnetized material that would be indicative of a magnon condensate. So here's some images where, for example, we take a picture of one component of the transverse magnetization of the gas. And we find at low magnon number, this is at a fixed temperature, at low magnon number, there's too few magnons for condensation, and there's not much order of the transverse magnetization to speak of. As we increase the number of magnons at constant temperature, they both condense. And we see that by the emergence of a macroscopic transverse magnetization, which is seen in these images. So we've also gone ahead and checked not just the position space distribution, but also the momentum space distribution of these magnons. And therefore, we know that the condensation occurs at a location which we can predict fairly well by theory. Even more than this, we can image actually not just one component, but both components of the transverse magnetization. So again, we imagine a system that is dominantly magnetized, let's say in the z-axis, but has maybe now, because of magnon condensation, has also some magnetization, macroscopic magnetization in the transverse directions. Those transverse directions, let's say x and y, you notice that they look like something like a plot in a complex plane, where the magnetization that we observe would be characterized both by an amplitude, which is, let's say, the magnitude of the complex number, but also by a direction in this two-dimensional space, which is like the phase of a complex number. And this mapping between magnetization and the phase or the wave function of an atom is not accidental, because in fact, the transverse magnetization that we observe, I'm worried that people have frozen.
No, you, all good.
Okay, I'm good, great. Somebody had frozen and my computer was slow.
Yeah, we could see you, we could hear you.
Okay, good. This pattern of magnetization in the magnon condensate is directly caused by the interference of the magnon condensate wave function with the rest of the superfluid in which it exists. So this picture here, which we take by measuring the transverse magnetization, is directly a picture of the wave function of the magnons, both the amplitude and the phase of the wave function. I find that pretty cool. And what we see in these images is also kind of striking. We see that the magnon condensate, in our experiment at least, does not form with a uniform magnetization. We don't totally understand why. And we also find that that uniform magnetization on occasion also includes defects. And these register the location of vortex defects that are in the wave function or in the magnon condensate wave function.
Then could I ask just to clarify a question?
Yes.
So when you say that you could measure essentially the wave function of the magnon condensate, as you explained, it breaks spontaneously both U1, that's the Bose-Einstein condensation, and the O3 symmetry of the spin space. Now, by measuring Mx and Y in horizontal plane, you're measuring that latter one, the SO3 broken down to one specific choice of direction. But as to overall phase of the wave function, are you also measuring that, the U1?
No, I can't measure the overall phase of the wave function, but the transverse magnetization is seen as the relative phase of the ferromagnetically ordered superfluid and the magnon condensate that's formed on top of it. It's the interference, the relative phase between these two things that I'm able to measure. So I'm using my ferromagnetic condensate as like a local oscillator to measure all aspects of this wave function.
I see. So are you also saying that it's not that there is a specific vector in MX and Y plane, rather that's an entire plane which is chosen with some complex coefficient?
When the magnon condensate forms, it would spontaneously choose a direction for its transverse magnetization.
Right. That's what you would expect. So why is it that you don't see a delta function peak at that direction, but instead you see a color diagram on the
periphery? Okay, so this is a real space image. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is a real image of one example of a magnon condensate that we prepared. Mm-hmm. You see the length scale here. And if the system had formed a uniform magnon condensate with long range order, then this should all be one color.
Oh, that makes sense now. Okay.
Yeah. But bizarrely, we don't totally understand the reasons fully, at least even over the longest time scale that we can study these things in the experiment, this thing does not develop true long range order. It remains quasi-condensed. You see that these are the domains that Randy wanted me to show. You see these sort of regions of different orientations of transverse spin. You see a lot of features at their boundaries. But this stuff never like coarsens all the way out to become uniform.
Then, since we're on the question, there's another question from our colleague Matt Foster. Matt, would you like to ask your question?
Sure, very quick. So are these static images? Do the domains fluctuate in time, or is it more or less frozen over some steady state?
Great question. So the way we form these images is by, we take a few optical images in rapid succession, we process the data, and this is how we can map out the transverse magnetization. Now, given that we can take a few optical images in succession, maybe we could actually wait a little while and measure it again, I don't know, a second later, and see whether these domains are also changing in time. We've not quite mastered the ability to do that. There's enough destructiveness in this measurement that actually making precise two-time correlations of this quantum gas, or really almost of any other quantum gas experiment, is beyond our reach.
The other question I had is just whether these vortices, have you tried like Kibble-Zurich scaling for defect production after a quantum quench? Is there?
Good. Right. So he's bringing up this Kibble-Zurich theory, which is an extension of Kadnoff's scaling theory to the time domain, if you will, and the prediction is that if you ramp across a phase transition, a symmetry breaking phase transition, then there will be a correspondence between how rapidly you ramp and how messed up is the inhomogeneity of the system because of the sort of limited causality, And the prediction would be that if you ramp more slowly, then you would have bigger domains and fewer defects. We do not see that scaling in this experiment. We vary that ramp scale all over the place. We basically see the same pattern. And we also see almost no coarsening over time. And I think those two things are linked. I think likely what happens is that by the time we can see things, there's been a stage of coarsening. And then the coarsening has some vast slowing down that occurs that keeps the system almost frozen from then on. That's my picture for what happens. But we've been confused about this from the get-go.
Great, thanks.
I also have a question, related question. In an earlier work of yours, you showed that the emergence of these magnetic vortices are due to the dipolar interaction. So does dipolar interaction play a role here, do you think?
Good question. I think the dipolar interaction, I don't know. Han, I don't know. We've done previous work where we measured the excitation spectrum of magnons. And in that work, we were able to see quite clearly an energy gap, even at a zero wave vector, for magnons in our system. So, you know, a magnon in a system that is symmetric should be a gapless excitation of the system. But in our case, the combination of dipolar interactions and some spatial anisotropy of the experiment breaks rotational symmetry. So magnons, in fact, can be gapped, and they are gapped. Now the question is whether that weak magnon, that weak dipolar energy, it could play a role maybe in stabilizing the system against coarsening. That is possible. One of the things we've thought is whether the length scale that we observe here in these images is somehow dictated by a dipolar interaction. I don't have anything conclusive to say about it. It's all roughly at the right scale, but it's not a convincing argument.
Thanks.
Dan, just to be clear, these domains are not repeatable, is that correct?
Yes, thanks, Randy. So each of these experiments, each of these images is from a different run of the experiment. And we just get one example. And then, as I told Matthew, we just have to throw away the atoms. And each image is different. I mean, there's some commonalities. There's a typical length scale here. There's a typical number of these vortices here, which is related to the length scales. But the fine details differ from one run to the next. All right, so for me, spinner gases is something like the mob. You know, I keep trying to get out of it and then they just keep drawing me back in. There's always something more to study in the realm of spinner gases. I was pointing already to big questions we have about equilibration and coarsening. I don't know, obviously somebody's gonna have to figure this out, and I'm hoping more groups will get involved in this research, and in particular, we'll make use of this high resolution imaging of magnetization that we use in order to answer these questions. I also am very tempted by experiments that would explore superfluid hydrodynamics, but where there's also a spin degree of freedom that turns out to be a kind of a new realm of hydrodynamics with interesting phenomena. I have a collaboration with a group out in Australia to look at this maybe in their labs. And then there's also many other systems where you can keep studying spinner physics. So there's lots of other atoms to explore. I've done experiments with sodium and rubidium. There have been now some nice works beginning in bosonic lithium. There's other atoms as well that have higher spin. There's transition metal atoms that we're trying to cool in my lab. So maybe that'll be a reason to return to the study of spinner gases. And then another sort of twig on a branch, which is on the overall tree of ultra cold atomic physics, is the study of heteronuclear spinner gas mixtures. Gas mixtures where there's two different spinner gases. Let's say one of them is lithium and the other one is rubidium, and they interact with one another. And they become an interesting thing to study again because rotational symmetry plays a role, and you have a hope of understanding the phenomena that occur there. I nominally would have told you a bunch about heteronuclear spinner gas physics that's going on in my lab, but I'm going to actually choose to kind of breeze through that really quick so I can get to what's essentially the second half of the talk. So I'll just tell you what we've done, but I won't really explain very much of it. One of the new things that can occur in heteronuclear spinner gases is that one spinner gas can exchange its magnetization with the other spinner gas. And this exchange you can monitor by studying the variation of the magnetic sublevels or of the magnetization of one gas versus another as a function of time. So we've done an experiment using a combination of two spinner gases. In our case, one of them is lithium, the other one is rubidium. And in that experiment, we're trying to characterize all of the types of interactions in which a magnetization can be exchanged between one gas and the other. These are all interactions where, as before, the total, let's say, projection of the spin of a colliding a pair of atoms is conserved, but where during the collision, the spin itself is exchanged between the two systems. There's three separate processes, and these separate processes are have a strength or a rate or a cross section or whatever that depends on scattering lengths. These scattering lengths are related to scattering lengths, these things A2, A1, and A0, that have to do with the microscopic physics when two of these atoms collide with one another. So we set out to try to measure all of these, to observe all these phenomena and characterize all these strengths. And the way we've chosen to do so is to work with a non-degenerate gas, and in particular, work with a gas where we have a small minority gas, that was our lithium gas, in contrast with a large majority gas. One way to think about this experiment is maybe in the language of spintronics or magnetoresistance experiments in solid state, where I would regard this big gas as something like a magnetic material, which has some kind of order, some kind of magnetic characteristic. And then I inject a small current of other itinerant particles. In spintronics, this would be electrons, but here these are bosonic lithium atoms. And we watch how their magnetization varies because they're in contact with this magnetic material. That's the analogy maybe I can make with solid state. So we start with different combinations of the lithium gas and the rubidium gas with different Zeeman state distributions. We put them in contact with each other in an optical trap for a while, and we observe the variation in the population and the different sublevels of lithium as a function of time. And a few things to know. One is that populations do evolve. So there is some spin relaxation that occurs because of the collisions between lithium and rubidium. And over several seconds, lithium evolves to some sort of steady state distribution, which is different for different settings of the rubidium magnetization reservoir. So I won't explain deeply how, but we can identify the role of each of these separate magnetization exchange processes in these dynamics. We can look at these data and now really quantitatively measure the strength, either the cross-section or the scattering length that characterizes each of these phenomena, and compare them, it happens to be fairly favorably, to theory. And then one last takeaway from this work is that now it's possible to think about spinner gas experiments which are sort of freed from these constraints. For example, the constraint of constant magnon number no longer has to hold because a magnon can basically give up its spin to the magnetic reservoir, which is the other spinner gas in which it's in contact. So for future experiments that might study things like thermodynamics and phase transitions in spinner gases, it might be useful to have them in contact with a reservoir of some other atomic species. Okay, but I wanted to move away from that topic to move to the second half of the talk, which concerns our experiments that are taking place on atoms in optical lattices. To relate it to the topic of magnetism, let me give this a try. The previous experiments had to do with phenomena that occur in systems that are magnetic. But you can ask the earlier question, why were these systems magnetic at all? So why, in general, do objects gain magnetic order? One way in which materials become magnetically ordered is can be understood by considering what happens if you take spins or magnetic moments and you place them in a regular geometric configuration that is like a lattice. Okay, so here's, let's say, a square lattice. And let's imagine that we have spins on each of these lattice sites, and they interact ferromagnetically and also as a Heisenberg interaction, which means that the actual orientation of the spins doesn't matter, it's just their relative orientation. Okay, so if I want to minimize the energy of a system given this, so a ferromagnetic Heisenberg interaction is one where spins at neighboring sites would like to point in the same direction to minimize the energy. So for example, at a neighboring site, I would place a spin that points in the same direction. And then I can look at another neighboring site, and because it already has an order, a neighbor for which the magnetic order has been chosen, we can fill in all the sites of the lattice, and we find indeed that the lowest energy configuration for spins in this system is one where they're all magnetically ordered in the same direction. That's a ferromagnet. Or we might have a system which is anti-ferromagnetically coupled, where spins on neighboring sites would like to point in opposite directions. Okay, fine. So here's one pair of sites connected by a bond, and these spins point in opposite directions. And again, that gives me enough guidance to determine the ground state of the system entirely. I just go, you know, site by site, and I place the spin down, and I can keep satisfying this anti-ferromagnetic coupling, and I find a ground state. In this case, it's a Nael anti-ferromagnet. Things are different in different kinds of lattice geometries. In particular, there are some lattice geometries where magnetic order becomes frustrated, where this simple scheme that I showed you, where when you lay down a couple of spins, you can figure out what the rest of the spins in the lattice do. There are some geometric configurations of a lattice where that's not possible. The one prime example of this is what's known as the Kagome lattice. A Kagome lattice is a lattice with a triangular construction. Here's a unit cell. And in this unit cell, there are three sites. So these are the sites with, label them, let's say A, B, and C within the unit cell. Now let's say the spins at these sites are anti-ferromagnetically coupled. So they want to point in opposite directions. Okay, I can't satisfy that requirement fully, but I can do pretty well. I can choose these three spins and I can cant them at 120 degree angles from one another. And that lowers the energy of anti-ferromagnetic spins, at least within this one three-site system. But now I say, well, let me fill out the spins for the rest of the lattice, given that I've gotten started. But you find that because this particular lattice has such sparse connectivity, that each triangular plaquette, as it's known, is only coupled to its neighbor by one vertex, there isn't enough guidance for the system to know how to order itself. So for example, if I look at these sites over here, if I look at this site here, am I supposed to copy this spin or this spin orientation into that site? And the answer is I could do either. And because of that, I end up finding that there's a macroscopic number of ways to organize the spins, all of which seem to have pretty low energy for anti-ferromagnetic interactions, but they're all different from one another. And how the system decides what its overall magnetic order might be is a very complicated question. And this speaks to this notion of frustration, which doesn't have to do only with the election results. It has also to do with the fact that in many solid state systems, even though the system is composed of very many particles, in fact, there's usually a principle that really simplifies your understanding of the system and allows you to understand it on the basis of essentially almost single particle physics. So for example, a metal, which is composed of very many electrons, has a Fermi surface. And the Fermi surface as a lower dimensional object kind of simplifies the treatment of a metal. All the action in the metal occurs only on that Fermi surface. You can kind of ignore everything else. Similarly, if you can write down one type of magnetic order, like as a cartoon or something, like I did in the previous slide, then that is a pretty good starting assumption for what the magnetic order of the entire system does. But here, the Kagome lattice in particular has a macroscopic number of spin configurations that all look like equally good candidates to become ordered. So there's no simplification to the problem. That means that it's probably going to be complicated, but also interesting when we find the solution. So it seemed worthwhile to study systems like this with ultra-cold atom representations as well. There's another aspect to geometric frustration in the cognitive. So that's my magnetization aside. But now we'll move into the real topic with the rest of what I'm going to tell you. Geometric frustration manifests itself not only in the spin degree of freedom, but also in the motional or the orbital degree of freedom, in at least in the Kagome lattice. Okay, so let's imagine we have this Kagome lattice, and I'm talking about the motion of particles that tunnel from site to site within this lattice. Imagine I had a single particle, and I place that single particle in a superposition of these six sites, which are inscribed inside of this hexagon that I've drawn. And moreover, let me say that the phase of the wave function in this superposition has opposite signs as I go around the edges of this hexagon. Well, now you conclude something interesting, which is that this single particle, which is initialized in this hexagonal state, can't go anywhere. It can't propagate. It's a stationary state. Let's say the particle wanted to hop over to this neighboring site on its way out to escape the hexagon. Well, it can. There's a probability amplitude that it tunnels from this site out, and a probability amplitude that it tunnels from this site out. But because of the opposite phases of the wave function here, those probability amplitudes cancel. And so there is no rate at all for the particle leaving this hexagon. That means that the motion of atoms in the Kagome lattice becomes frustrated. The atoms can't go anywhere, or the objects, the itinerant particles can't go anywhere. Now imagine a Kagome lattice, you know, a big two-dimensional plane filled with this geometric pattern that I'm showing. And on every one of these hexagonal patterns that shows up in the Kagome lattice, I can write down a state which is localized there and which doesn't evolve, so it's an eigenstate. And of course, it has the same energy regardless of where I place it, because this is a translationally invariant system. And these many eigenstates of the system, all at the same energy, can also be described as a band within the band structure, which has zero dispersion. So all these states that are all degenerate with one another, they have to be located somewhere on this in band structure. And the way we represent them in band structure is by claiming that one of the bands is completely flat. It has no dispersion. There's a deep connection between the geometric frustration of motion and the geometric frustration of magnetism. This is something that's been known for some time. So for example, when people were trying to understand the orbital motion effect, which is the quantum Hall states, they appealed to the physics of spin configurations and let's say spin liquids in the magnetization sector. So the equivalence between the two things has been noted for a while. Okay, so we were interested in doing experiments that would just be very, very simple to start with and just seeing whether we could make a Kagome lattice and then whether we could probe its band structure and just confirm that it's flat. I mean, Mathematica tells me it's flat, so it must be flat. But anyhow, let's go ahead and do an experiment to confirm what Mathematica produces. Okay, so we have to make a Kagome lattice, and this is something we've learned how to do. We make an optical lattice by taking laser beams, plane waves of light, that intersect at particular angles with one another. And the interference pattern of those laser beams creates a periodic variation of intensity in space. Atoms interact with that spatially varying intensity as if it's basically a spatially varying potential. And the periodicity of that intensity pattern creates a periodic potential landscape, which is a lattice. So in this experiment, we're going to create actually two lattices, and we're going to lay them on top of one another. Both lattices are triangular in the sense that they're formed with three beams that intersect in a plane. One of them uses a short wavelength of light. The other one uses a long wavelength of light, which is a commensurate value. And the nature of the interaction between atoms in this light field is that atoms, our rubidium atoms that we're working with, they interact with this green laser light and they huddle in the locations where the laser light has a maximum a minimum intensity. So that's like a triangular lattice of sites. Whereas they interact with this pattern of light, which forms on its own a hexagonal lattice, by going to the regions of this lattice where it has the maximum intensity. And so you see, let's say in this pattern that there's three sites of the green lattice where there's a lot of red light. So that's the one that the atoms are attracted to. But there's one site of the green lattice where there's very little light. So that is relatively high in energy. And the total optical potential we generate is exactly a Kagome lattice, where there's a triangular plaquette that connects to other triangular plaquettes at the vertex. Experimentally, what we do is we produce light at the one wavelength, 1064 nanometers. We also frequency double that light to produce light at half the wavelength. We take these beams of light and we combine them into a cell so that they're propagating in three directions at equal angles. And now we have to also make sure that this lattice is perfectly oriented, or translation is placed with respect to this other lattice in a particular manner so that we generate the Kagome lattice geometry. So we need to be able to control the interference phase of both the green light and the infrared light so that they overlap with each other well. And the way we do that is with interferometers, where we do interference of both the red light and the green light. We have a way of stabilizing this interferometer to an arbitrary phase using feedback, and that's what stabilizes our experiment. So in order to measure the band structure of the Kagome lattice in the excited band, right in this third band of the Kagome lattice, I have to come up with a way of taking a gas of atoms and putting it at some value of the quasi-momentum and at some value of the band index. So here's how we do that. We use some simple concepts from condensed matter physics. So let's imagine that I take atoms that start off both condensed in my system at zero momentum, and I put a force on them, and I accelerate them up to some momentum that's different from zero, okay? Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna adiabatically turn on the lattice potential. Let's say when we push the atoms, the lattice potential was off, but then once the atoms are already moving, we adiabatically increase up the lattice potential. What happens? Well, let me bring you over to this picture, which is just what happens in one dimension. It turns out that the band structure in a material can be mapped one-to-one onto the momentum states of a particle. So if I take an object and I accelerate it up, let's say to this velocity, and now I adiabatically ramp on the lattice potential, the energy of this particle will change. Its quasi-momentum will be conserved, and it will be mapped exactly into the first band of the lattice. And that's because what I've done is I've pushed the object, the atom, out of the first Brillouin zone into the second Brillouin zone. And in that second Brillouin zone, the mapping is onto the n equals two band of a lattice. We're gonna follow that same procedure in a two-dimensional setting, now dealing with the Kagome lattice. So again, here's a picture in velocity space, or momentum space, if you will, where I've drawn out the Brillouin zones for our lattice, for our triangular lattice. And the way to understand these Brillouin zones is the following. If I take an atom and I push it so that its initial velocity is somewhere within this green region, then when I ramp up the lattice, it will adiabatically map onto the lowest band, the n equals one band of the lattice. And that's what defines this as the first Brillouin zone. If I push an atom to where its initial velocity lies within this blue region, now I ramp up the lattice adiabatically, I map the atom onto the n equals two band, and that's the n equals two Brillouin zone. In our experiment, we take a rubidium gas, which starts off at zero momentum, and we give it a push. We use optical forces to push it, let's say upwards on the page here. And the more we push on them, the more we're gonna displace them along this yellow vector here, this yellow path that's shown in the Brillouin zone diagram. So depending on how far I push my atoms before we ramp up the lattice, the atoms will find their way either into the N equals one, the ground band of the Kagome lattice, or when they've skipped over the K point, they will go into the N equals three band of the Kagome lattice. That's the one that's nominally flat. And if I push further, I can get them also into the N equals four band of the Kagome lattice. So that's how we load atoms into the lattice at a particular wave vector and into a particular band.
Real quick question, Dan.
Yeah.
So adiabatic here means it's got to be slow compared to what, H bar over the band gap or something like that?
It should be slow compared to these gaps that are shown here.
Okay.
Right. Thanks. So if I want to do this kind of mapping at a band edge, you know, not going to work. That's also interesting. Something happens, but we won't go into a single band. So as long as we stay away from the band edges, we should be good. And that's why, for example, for illustration, I've chosen here a few points that are pretty safely away from the band edges. Okay, so now let's just confirm that we know what we're doing. So we take our atoms, we push them, we load them into a lattice, let them evolve for a little while maybe, and then we switch off the lattice and we look at the velocity distribution of the atoms. We're characterizing the block states of the Kagome lattice by looking at them in velocity space. So these are the velocity space images that we obtain experimentally at these four different points, either at the gamma point, elsewhere in the ground band, at this nice place within the N equals three band of the Kagome lattice, or even the N equals four band. And we compare these patterns to the patterns we get, let's say, just based on single particle calculations of band structure. And you see that at a qualitative level, things match pretty well. So it does seem like indeed by this method, I can take an entire Bose condensate and stick it into the flat band of a Kagome lattice. That's pretty interesting. Now what? Now what do we want to do with this? Let's be a little bit more quantitative with these images. And in particular, I'm going to use these images to determine what's known as the group velocity. Okay. The group velocity in band structure is defined as the gradient of the energy of the band. And also by this theorem, the Hellman-Feynman theorem, there's an exact relation that tells me that the group velocity is also identical to the average velocity of the block state. Okay, maybe not surprising, but anyhow, that's the relation. And what that means is that I can look at these images, I can calculate the average velocity. That tells me what is the gradient of the band energy. And in particular, if I want to confirm that the flat band is really flat, I want to confirm that the group velocity in the flat band is zero. So here's our measurements of the group velocity by this method at points within the first Brillouin zone, the third, and the fourth. And what you see screaming out at you is that the flat band of the Kagome lattice is definitely not flat. The atoms in the N equals three band have a significantly non-zero group velocity. This dashed line is what we would have expected based on just the single particle treatment of our lattice. There's a little bit of residual group velocity here because we haven't excluded the fourth site in the unit cell infinitely yet in energy. So that gives a little bit of non-flatness to the band, but we definitely get a very large group velocity compared to that. How can we understand this unflattening of the flat band? We've come across this picture. So let's go to this state, which is in the third band of the Kagome lattice at a particular location in quasi-momentum. And let's examine it not in terms of its distribution in velocity space, which is shown here. Let's look at the distribution of this block state in position space. There's also a position space wave function. And the density, the probability density of that wave function is shown here. So here's the three sites of the Kagome lattice, A, B, and C. They all have the same lowest energy of the optical lattice potential. But you see that for the block state itself, the populations are not equal in the three sites. The block state itself does not have the same symmetry as the lattice in which it propagates. And the reason is that we've given the atoms a push in a specific direction, And that's broken the C3 symmetry of the problem. And so it should not be surprising that the real space wave function of the atoms does not have the same C3 symmetry that the lattice itself does. Okay, so what? Well, the so what is that now the atoms also repel one another. And that means that, you know, marginally, if I think about the potential in which each atom moves, it moves in a potential which is the sum of the underlying optical lattice potential, the Kagome lattice, but also the spatially periodic mean field energy that it experiences because of repulsion from the other atoms. And that means that the atoms now self-generate a lattice, which is no longer the Kagome lattice, which no longer has C3 symmetry, which no longer has a flat band. And that kind of picture explains our data. That's basically explained by this black line that is in fairly good agreement with our data. So to just point out what was exciting to us about these data, first of all, one thing we thought was really great was that we've now learned how to place atoms into any of the bands of our Kagome lattice, including this N equals three band, which is nominally flat. And there's really interesting predictions for what a bunch of interacting atoms will do in trying to establish some kind of order, let's say trying to Bose condense inside of a flat band. So this would be a nice starting point for experiments that probe that question. Unfortunately, we find that the atoms in our excited band of the Kagome lattice are not very stable. Within hundreds of microseconds, some kind of collisions occur and the atoms rain down into the other bands of the lattice. That might be something that we know how to turn off, or maybe it's a showstopper for these experiments, I'm not sure. But one thing that definitely crept up from our experiment is the complications that are added because of nonlinearities when we think about, or interaction effects, when we think about band structure in a solid. Now, band structure is, you know, an interesting preoccupation in solid state physics. Not just are we interested in bands and band gaps and whether systems are metallic and insulating and stuff, but there's also increasingly in condensed matter physics, we've been studying band geometry effects. So sort of geometric or topological features of band structure and how they show up in terms of the effects of the properties of materials. And now we have a nice opportunity to study whether these geometry effects, and there's many of them, whether they persist also under the influence of interactions. You've seen that flat bands don't remain flat when atoms are interacting with one another. What about effects of band geometry? Do they go awry? So this is the most recent data we have out of the lab, and this will be the last thing I'll try to tell you about. We've been focusing in particular on the physics at a band touching point. So many of you at Rice have been studying carbon materials for a while, including graphene, which has a geometry of this honeycomb crystalline geometry. And one feature of this honeycomb lattice is the existence of Dirac points at the edges of the Brillouin zone. These are locations where the lower band and the upper band touch and where the energy varies linearly across that touching point. Now, as many of you I'm sure know, there's a way of thinking about the states of electrons or of atoms or something in the vicinity of this touching point. You can think about the upper band and lower band, or maybe the A and B sites of the honeycomb lattice as some kind of pseudo-spin. And you can ask, what is the Hamiltonian that describes the energy of these states right near the Dirac point in terms of this pseudo-spin basis? And the answer is that near the Dirac point, in some kind of pseudo-spin language, if you push an atom away from the Dirac point, the states are determined as if the atom now sees some kind of pseudo-magnetic field that separates the energy of two spin states. And that magnetic field winds around once in a circle as you go around the Dirac point. And the fact that it winds around exactly once tells you a lot about the physics that occurs near that point. That's this geometric effect. There have been nice experiments certainly in solid state physics all over the place, but also in atomic physics to characterize the singularity that occurs at Dirac points or linear touching points in band structure. One of the most remarkable ones was done a number of years ago by the Bloch group, where they used interference or interferometry to measure the Berry phase. So they take a gas of atoms, Bose condensate, they split it into two different spin states, and they drag the, let's see what happened. They drag the two spin states so that they enclose a path that surrounds the Dirac point. And then they go ahead and they measure the interference between these two states. And they find that whenever that path has encircled the Dirac point, there's a jump in the phase of the interference pattern by pi. And that pi is exactly the Berry phase that I would measure if I took an object and I dragged it around a circle around the Dirac point. So this was a beautiful way of characterizing the singularity at the Dirac point. We've been recently playing with a different way of doing the same thing, not by going around the Dirac point, but going right through it. And the experiments we've been doing most recently are the following. We take atoms, our Bose condensate, we put them in a honeycomb lattice. For us, that's the lattice just generated by the infrared light on its own. And we push them. Actually, we accelerate the lattice instead of the atoms. That's a subtlety I don't want to get into too much. But we accelerate them to the Dirac point. And then we hook a turn and we leave the Dirac point on a path that circumscribes a certain angle. And after we've left the Dirac point, we characterize how many atoms are in the lower band or the upper band at that point. And what we expect to see is, let's say, the population in the lower band goes as cosine squared of this angle theta divided by 2. And this 2, this 1/2 factor, is related exactly to the pi that was measured previously by the Bloch group. So here's how the experiments are done. We put atoms in a Kagome lattice. We accelerate, in this case, the lattice to put the atoms at the Dirac point. We then hook a turn at some fixed angle, a theta. And then we determine by the inverse process of now ramping down the lattice, we determine in which band the atoms are located, right? So for example, if I go like this and I hook a turn by this angle, I expect to see a population which is largely in the first excited state of the lattice. Here's the pictures that we see in band mapping, okay? So this dot here represents the population of atoms that are in the ground band. This dot within this piece of the Brillouin zone, that's the second Brillouin zone. So that's the populations of the n equals 2 band of the lattice. And so indeed, for this sort of oblique angle, most of the population is sent into the first excited state of the band of the lattice and is taken out of the ground band of the lattice. And by analyzing these kinds of images for various values of the rotation angle, we get data that look like this. And this blue line here is the population that remains in the ground band as a function of angle. And you see that at first blush, and these data are preliminary, it really does look like cosine squared of theta over 2. So that's another way of characterizing band structure. And we'll be interested in eventually seeing the effects of interactions on this kind of physics as well. So that brings me to the conclusion of a discursive talk. What I've generally tried to convey is that ultra-cold atoms are interesting to study in general as a kind of material, but also perhaps in terms of connecting to and understanding better phenomena that occur in solid state materials. I talked to you about one example of such a quantum simulation work, which was the study of magnon condensation, where we definitely benefited by the fact that we could see very clearly what was happening in our system. We could take really compelling images that give us a lot of information. I told you only briefly about our foray into heteronuclear spinner physics, and in particular, the fact that we can characterize all the different types of magnetization exchange interactions in that system. And then I concluded by telling you some of the games we've been playing about band structure. One notable result is the renormalization of the Kagome lattice band structure, where the flat band is no longer flat. And then the beginnings of a study of, I think it's, it probably is related to the concept of Wilson loops, where we can characterize singularities in band structure. We're interested in doing this both at the linear Dirac point, sorry, the linear band touching point, such as I've shown you, but also the quadratic band touching that occurs, let's say, in the Kagome labs. So let me conclude. So I'll thank the funders of various parts of this work. Let me also point out the people that did the work that I'm mostly telling you about. Feng was the leader in the magnon condensation and the heteronuclear spinner physics group, joined by Aaron and then the postdoc, Josh Isaacs. Delilah is an undergraduate. Maybe you'll see her applying to Rice sometime soon. And then all the work on the optical lattice experiments was led by Zeffy and Charles, and also with supporting younger graduate students. There's a lot of stuff going on in my group that I did not take the time to tell you about. I didn't tell you about our experiments on atoms in optical cavities, where we're studying the fluctuations in evaporative cooling, and also where we're now trapping single atoms and tweezers inside of a cavity. I didn't tell you about our efforts to try to laser cool a new species of atoms, in particular titanium at first. I didn't tell you about my involvement in trying to put quantum gases in space and to do experiments in microgravity. And I did not tell you about what is taking up almost all my time these days, which is directing one of these new National Science Foundation QLCI institutes, but that's certainly gonna transform my work in the coming years. And with that, at long last, let me conclude. Thanks.
Thank you, Dan. I'm sure there are questions that are slung from Tom. Tom, do you have a question? I have a question then. So the metastability of the, I'm getting an echo. The metastability of these higher bands, is it, you mentioned the fact that it was unconfined in the third dimension. Is that the dominant lifetime effect, or is it unstable in general?
I don't know.
I don't know if you heard that.
I heard the question, and the answer is that I don't know. Okay. We've not done a great job of diagnosing what happened. We're gonna have to add a lattice in the third dimension to cut off that escape route. We will probably want to look at whether the lifetime is different in different parts of the Brillouin zone. Maybe the place where we put the atoms was particularly unstable. Maybe put them at a high symmetry point like the gamma point or the K point or something, they'd be more stable. I'm not quite sure. I do expect that there should be like a modulational instability, kind of like a soliton formation. Mm-hmm. Which would allow atoms in the flat band to become denser, increasing their energy, which then allows other atoms to fall into the ground band. So I think that might be physics that we would see, but we'll have to get there.
Okay.
Chimiao C has a question.
Yes, I do. I was interested in this flat band as well. And I was wondering whether, I mean, presumably these are bosons, and I'm not sure whether you are loading the particles into the flat band. And if you could, interactions would do cause effects more than just renormalizing the bands. And one could at least imagine that if it's really that flat that you sketched.
Yeah. So good question. So we're working with bosons at present. Yes, we are putting them all into the flat band. Mm-hmm. And now you're asking the question about what would happen with interactions among atoms within a flat band. So that's something where there have been some very nice papers written already investigating that question. And you know it's an interesting question because frustration is involved, right? That there's no obvious place or no obvious momentum. There's no obvious choice for the atoms to become Bose condensed. There's no single particle state cheat sheet that tells the atoms what to do. So that kind of has the hallmarks of frustration, and therefore that might lead to some interesting phases that you might not have expected.
I mean, frustration.
There was work by, sorry, what's that?
frustration indeed, but also on top of that, if you have huge degeneracy of the flat band, then interaction could push, you know, relieve the degeneracies in all sorts of ways. And,
yes, right. That's another way of saying the same thing, is because we've ironed out the kinetic energy from the system, then interactions have to determine what happens, and that's going to become interesting.
Right.
So there have been a number of predictions. There's this work by Huber and Altman that talks about a progression of states from a Wigner crystal that forms at low filling to a super solid that forms on top of the Wigner crystal at intermediate filling to just a uniform superfluid that occurs at high filling. There's another work out of Hui Shai's group in Tsinghua, which talks exactly about the physics that we saw, which is the renormalization of band structure, and suggests that if the Bose condensate would just form at the right momentum, then it would renormalize the band structure so that now everything is excited, that it's in its it will establish a new minimum self-consistently.
Yeah. Thank you.
So that's what's predicted, but I don't totally know what will happen. That was one of the more interesting questions that we want to get into, but that of course is contingent, because for us, the flat band is an excited band. It's contingent on the answer to Randy's question about whether there's any stability for bosons in the flat band. You know, I'm not putting all my bets on one state. I am also going to invest in fermions. And so we're also building up the capacity to add fermions to this experiment. And then I think it's an easier problem. We can just basically fill up the Fermi level to where the Fermi energy is in the flat band, just at the right filling. And then I think interesting physics will follow. And that's also stable. So that probably is a better approach in the coming years to some of this interesting physics. Nobody wants to take me to task for the use of the term Wilson loop. It's got to be a field theorist in the audience who could tell me what I was doing.
All right. Well, let's thank Dan again. And if there are no questions, let's go thank Dan. And